Hi everyone, this is Shanti Kumaraswamy Street from English with a Twist for another lesson on Wednesdays with English with a Twist. Hi guys, hope, and this is today's the last lesson for 2016. So I'm delighted. Today I'm in Malaysia again, but this time we're in a different place, and I'm here in my brother's apartment. And I'd like to introduce you to my brother, Roberto Kumaraswamy. And I'm delighted that he's joining me in this lesson. And you know, as you're coming into this lesson, do let me know where you're from, who you are, and you know, we will be chatting. And in today's lesson, I'm going to be asking my brother Roberto a number of questions to do with business and doing business in Malaysia. But before we start, I just want to remind you guys that if you haven't looked at my website, then do have a look at englishwithatwist.com. And do sign up to my free e-guide, which is the top 10 tips on how to be better communicators in business with English. So don't forget to do that. And anyway, let me just see, I'm gonna be looking down. Hi, Summit. You're from London, eh? Hi, it's 10 o'clock in the morning for you. Hi from London. It's a lot warmer here than in London, I bet. All right, thanks for joining. Anyway, we've got 30 minutes and I've got lots here to share with you. So first of all, my brother is, I have never worked in Malaysia. So all my adult life was in the UK. So all my experience is with the British. And if you remember in lesson 4, we talked about the top 10 tips on how to do business with the British. While we're here, I'm with my brother on our Christmas holiday. I thought, what a better way than to share with you his experience and his advice, his tips he would give you, were you to plan, were sent to Malaysia to work in Malaysia. Because Malaysia is still very much a country where English is spoken in business. We are a former colony of the British Empire, so most businesses do conduct their work in the English language. So if you were to come here, this is what you'd be doing. And what I wanted to see is how different the Malaysians are in business compared to the British. So there you go. So what I wanted to do was to look at my brother's CV. He kindly shared it with me. So Roberto, you have been working in Malaysia for over 20 years now, haven't you?
Yep, that's correct, yeah.
Great, and you started in a large blue chip company?
Yep, I started out in a large tobacco company actually, terrible, but yes, tobacco back in those days. I started out as a management trainee.
Right, okay, so management trainee.
Yeah.
And I would be right in saying that all your adult life, your professional life, has been in Malaysia and also in Indonesia?
Yeah, so I've been working for about 20 years. And I spent out of those 20 years, 1.5 years in Indonesia, in Jakarta. But yeah, so pretty much most of my experience is in Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur.
Great, okay. So, wonderful. And now, you went to university like me. We both went to university in the UK, so then you moved here. This is where also our father lives, and this is where we grew up. So you decided to come back and build your career here. Great. So you've obviously got a ton of experience with dealing with Malaysians. And of course, if you could explain to the audience out there, who are Malaysians in terms of the ethnic diversity we have in Malaysia?
Right, yeah, so Malaysia is quite a complex country and it's quite unique. There are not many countries like Malaysia in the sense that it has, when you say Malaysian, it just means the nationality. But it's primarily made out of three main ethnic groups. So the majority are the Malays, which is not to be confused with Malaysians, because again, Malays are the ethnicity, Malaysians are the nationality. So the Malays, which are probably about 60% of the population. Then we have about 30% Chinese and about 8% or so Indians. And then the rest, which is a combination of different ethnicities, you know, whether they be from the West or people from East Malaysia, etc. So it's a whole bunch of different races, which makes it a very interesting place to live in.
Yeah. And would you say that with the Malaysians, almost like the British, when we talk about the British, we talk about a nationality, but there are ethnic differences. Having said that, in Malaysia, we are much more, you know, when we talk Malaysians, we don't automatically assume Malays. So yes, as you say, it's the Chinese and Indians. And have you had experience working with all three ethnic groups?
Yes, definitely. I mean, in almost every company, you will get a combination of those three, and much more than three, to be honest, because then we also have a lot of people from different nationalities that work here, right? Expats. And those expats may be, you know, from somewhere in Europe or America or Australia, etc. So we've got a whole bunch of different people.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So expat, which is the expatriate community. That's what we mean when we talk about the expat. Great. So you've had that. Now, what I was going to do is, if you remember, all of you, I was looking at the 10 tips on how to do business with the British. And so I'm going to ask Roberto what his 10 tips are. I'm going to compare the tips I gave on the British and see what it's like with the Malaysians. Are they different? And how do we work? So tip one, I remember, when with the British, is when you're going to arrange a meeting with the British and you're going to go for a business meeting, you need to always be punctual. If you're not going to be punctual for whatever reason, there are problems with the traffic or there's anything, then of course we need to inform them with the phone or anything. You always need to tell the British, because it is bad manners if you don't tell them. So with the Malaysians, what is it like? If I arrange a meeting with a Malaysian in a Malaysian company, what is it like? Are you always punctual for meetings?
So the thing with Malaysians are generally known to not be very punctual. Okay. So, you know, the stereotype of a Malaysian, again, this is really generalizing because I already mentioned that there's the diversity amongst the, you know, that the ethnic groups, but in general, Malaysians are not known to be punctual. So, you know, there's this, you know, funny thing about Malaysians when you call them and, you know, they might be late. And when you call them and you ask them where they are, they're always on the way, right? And whether it's 5 minutes away or an hour away, they'll always say they're on the way, right? And then they'll be 30 minutes later. But generally, of course, in business, it always pays to be punctual. Even in Malaysia, it's still considered a good thing to try and do or to do. And, but yeah, it's, you know, it's not as, five, 10 minute delay is kind of acceptable. It's not the end of the world. But if it's a formal meeting or it's client meeting, etc., you generally do need to try and inform them. So it always pays to be as courteous as you can.
Okay.
But Malaysians are not known for their punctuality.
Punctuality. Yeah. Okay, just a bit like the Italians. And, you know,
yeah, so Malaysian Italians, yeah. The worst combination ever. Yeah.
So you know, beware if you're going to have a meeting with Italians and Malaysians put together. But good to know. Okay, so, but you know, you have a 10-15 minute leeway. Great. In terms of tip two was about business greetings, if you remember. So when we greet British people, we often shake hands with them, and we, upon arrival, and give them a firm handshake, brief eye contact, nice smile, and you know, good to meet you, nice to meet you. How is it done in with Malaysians?
Yeah, so in Malaysia, I mean, it's pretty much the same thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, you generally shake people's hands and and give them a greeting, you know, nice to meet you, whatever it may be. The only exception is because, as I say, the vast majority of Malays, almost all of them, are Muslim.
Mm-hmm.
One has to be careful when it comes to, if you're dealing with a Malay woman.
Okay.
Some are very modern and very westernized and will be okay shaking your hands. But generally, when it comes to Malay women, it's best not to shake their hands, especially if you're a man. Well, if you're a man, you generally don't offer your hand.
Mm-hmm.
Because in Malay Muslim culture, that's not a polite thing to do. A man doesn't shake a woman's hand or doesn't touch a woman in any way, really, unless they're married. So if you want to be on the safe side and if you notice it's a Malay woman, you may not want to extend your hand. You may just want to greet, and if she extends a hand, then you can obviously shake it, if you're a man. But otherwise, you know, if you're dealing with a man, and you're a woman, let's say, and you're dealing with a man, yes, you can always offer to shake their hands. It's
right,
pretty customary as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's just not do anything unless she, of course,
Yes.
And
yes.
That's just
if
purely
she's a Malay
for Muslim
yeah,
Malay.
Correct.
And the Malays are
pretty almost all Muslims.
Almost all
yeah.
Muslims
yeah.
in Malaysia. Right. Okay. Good to know. So that is an important thing to bear in mind. Okay. Tip three was looking at how formal or informal we are in business. And with the British over the years, we have become less formal. If you remember in that lesson, we become less formal. So for example, often we address each other with first name basis, even with senior management. But if, for example, it's a colleague, a client you've met for the first time, perhaps you would address them in the first meeting as Mr. and Mrs. And then often they would say to you, please call me by their first name. And then you would reply saying the same. What is it like in Malaysia?
Yeah, it's similar. The thing is, it's hard to generalize nowadays because there's such a diversity of companies. Right, you've got this whole rise of startup culture and, you know, informality when it comes to these kind of companies where they operate in a very informal way. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you're going into a large corporation and you're dealing with maybe somebody senior, and not necessarily senior in terms of position, but senior in terms of age, they may expect a more formal, you know, slightly more old-fashioned way of greeting them. But of course, if you're meeting someone for the first time, play it safe. You know, greet them with Mr. or Mrs. or whatever it may be, and then take their lead. You know, if they tell you to call them by name, you do. If they don't, you just carry on calling them. Mm. You know, by their Mr. Whatever, right, or Miss Whatever, and that's it. But again, if you're dealing with a very casual, young startup kind of culture, which we have a lot here, often you can just go in straight for their name.
Right.
Yeah, and typically you would have set up the meeting and they would already have given you, you know, they would have already signed off with just their name.
Yes.
Rather than, you know, Mr. Whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
But what about if you were in a bigger company and you have a hierarchy, so you have senior management and then you've got a board. What is the expectation in Malaysia? Is it still that senior management
correct.
Is still need to be
addressed? So I mean Asian culture generally when it comes to business is still more formal than the West. So again, it very much depends. Mm-hmm. If you're in a large corporation which has a large management structure and it's a bit more made up of, you know, older people and
yes.
more traditional people, yes, they would expect that. And in Malaysia, you also have titles.
Right.
So, you know, it may not just be Mr., it may be one of the various titles that Malaysian people can get. Like Dato, Tan Sri, etc. And then you call them by that title and then their surname or their name. So it's hard to kind of say that it's only in one way because it really does depend.
Yes.
In some organizations, you've got some very senior people who are also more traditional, but they insist that they start calling them by name. You know, they're trying to act cooler and more like, you know, informal, etc. Because they've read that in the latest management book, well, that's how to, you know, treat your staff nowadays. So it depends.
So,
but in general, yes, I would say large corporations are more formal in Asia than they are, well, in Malaysia than they are in perhaps England or certainly more so than in America.
Right.
Yeah.
So how anyone coming to Malaysia, starting out here, what would you advise them to do? Follow the lead or see what the company culture is?
Yeah, you just need to see what kind of company you're dealing with. Are
yes.
you dealing with a lot of foreigners? Obviously, if you're dealing with a foreigner, you treat them in the same way that culture. So let's say you have a meeting and you're meeting a British person who happens to be the boss or the manager of an organization. You can obviously treat him in the same rules that you would follow with a British person, because
mm-hmm.
obviously he's going to be used to that. If you're dealing with a Malaysian, whether it be a Malay or a Chinese, etc., you need to gauge whether he's a younger person or he's an older person. Is he in a large corporate organization or is in a very informal startup, and you need to get a sense of how you've set that meeting up.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if it's been casual exchanges by email that have led you to set that meeting up and you've done it directly with them, you're pretty sure that it can be quite an informal meeting.
Yes.
If it's gone through their secretary or their, you know, their gatekeepers, etc., start off the meeting with a formal greeting.
Okay. Great. Now you said you said the word gatekeeper.
Yes.
So what would you? All right. What is a gatekeeper? Yeah.
Okay. So what I mean by a gatekeeper, typically typically their personal assistant or their secretary, etc. So in a lot of organizations, especially the large one, the senior management have a secretary or an assistant, you know, and it's very hard to get direct access, at least before you know them, to that manager or to that director. So, you know, all meetings are routed through these assistants who kind of guard the gate.
Exactly. So it's like an idiomatic expression we use as a gatekeeper. You imagine someone guarding the gate, and so then that's what we use also in English. It's someone that's, you know, stopping you, or they are screen. We use it's like also when you screen calls, you're stopping them from seeing the senior people. Great, thank you. Great. So the next point, which is tip four, we got to, is we've talked a lot about this, and we know that with the British, small talk is very important. We like it to engage in small talk in the different situations we might find ourselves in business. And I always say, and I always advise my clients, and like I've said to my followers here, is that before the start of any meeting, the British will expect to engage in some small talk. Maybe even if you've just met them at reception, and as you're going up on the lift to the meeting boardrooms, then they'll start asking you, you know, how was, you know, do you find it okay? Was the traffic bad? That sort of thing. With the Malaysians, do they expect small talk, or is it not something they are comfortable with?
Yeah, so I mean, again, it depends on at what stage of interacting with that person you're at that particular meeting. So for example, if you're in the elevator or so on, and you know, or you're at the lobby or at the reception of the office or whatever it may be, and they come and greet you, yes, I mean, definitely a little bit of small talk helps.
Yes.
Again, you need to gauge the personality of the person, which is hard to do until you know them. But my advice would be to a little bit follow their lead. Mm-hmm. If they come across as very friendly and very chatty, that's what you go back with. You know, you can also make a little bit of small talk with them. If they come across as a bit stiff and a bit formal, generally they're probably not the types to want to indulge in a lot of small talk.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you can kind of keep it to the minimum and then get down to business. When you then enter the meeting room or the boardroom or whatever you're there to do, again, it's hard to say that there's one rule fits all. Obviously, if you're in a larger room presenting maybe to a number of different people, you may, as I say, unless they're engaging in a lot of small talk amongst themselves, or they're asking you, or they are, you know, giving you small talk, you may want to just not indulge too much in that and get straight into business, right? And get straight into the presentation. So my advice is just read, you know, let them take the lead and react to their style.
Okay.
Yeah. So if they don't say much, you don't need to say much. You kind of get straight into it. If they're very chatty, which some people are, respond in that way, right? Don't be all curt and kind of get down. Let me get straight to business and let me present what I have to present, because they all expect that. And there's also a bit of a difference between the ethnicities. So generally, Malay culture tends to be a bit more, they want to indulge in small talk a bit more. Chinese tend to be a little bit more kind of straight to the point. But again, these are broad generalizations. You know?
Okay.
So
it also depends on the person.
So best advice I can give is just react to what they do. Because typically, if you're in a meeting, you're in their territory, you're in their, you know, in their office, they will typically show you how to interact with them.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So great advice. So it's very much follow the lead, So it's very much also observing what the other person's doing and how they're also communicating. I just want to digress from my tips, because one of the things that's also very important with small talk and also communicating with people is looking at the non-verbal communication they share. And one of the things we talked about earlier was where, of course, you greet someone, and perhaps where we have a Muslim lady, then of course we don't have the handshake. Non-verbal communication, so it'll be body language. Is there been anything that you would say is different with, I mean, do they have, for example, eye contact? Do you maintain good eye contact with people? Or is it rude? I mean, no, I never say to people to stare. But smiling, having good open posture and good eye contact, is it something that is important for Malaysians, and do they do that?
Yeah, so I mean generally the general rules of body language when it comes to how you present apply, right? So obviously you want to act confident, you want to, you know, you want to stand up tall, etc. That all applies. Mm-hmm. Probably the audience, the difference between maybe a Western audience and a Malaysian audience, if they're locals, mm-hmm. Is they may not be as responsive as perhaps a Western audience.
Okay.
So they may not give you as much non-verbal feedback, or even verbal feedback in the sense of nodding or, you know, kind of shaking their head or going, aha, or yes, okay, those kind of things. Again, it depends,
yes.
You know, because obviously people who have a stronger personality will, and they'll interrupt you and they may ask questions, etc. But when it comes to dealing with larger corporations, there have been times, I mean, many times, when you're making a presentation, you're you know, talking to a group, you get no reaction.
Right.
And then it looks like they're not interested and they just are falling asleep and they don't really care what you say. But they're actually not, it's just the way they are. And you know, you end your presentation, you go, any questions? And they don't have any, right? And then you think, oh, you know, damn, they really don't care about what I just talked about. But it's not always the case. They're just a bit more reserved. But again, these are just, you know, it doesn't apply all the time, but I think that would probably be a difference between a Western audience who are far more willing perhaps to ask you questions, to maybe interrupt your presentation, versus the, let's say, Asian style, which is a little bit more polite, where they'll kind of generally let you get through your presentation and then they'll ask you questions.
Right.
But, you know, you get some who are, you know, very westernized and will interrupt you all the time, you know, so it really depends.
Yes.
Yeah.
And did you find that when you, as you were building, because of course, you know, you finished your education in Europe and then when you started working, did you find that difficult at the beginning when you were giving presentations, or did you just, you learned, it became, you know, I mean, how do you find it? I mean, because, you know, of course, you know, we both have a Western side
to
us.
Yeah.
Do you find that strange sometimes giving a presentation and not getting much feedback, both verbally?
Yeah, I mean, of course, it's a little bit unnerving when you, finish your presentation and you don't get a single question and they've all got this blank stare on their faces kind of thing.
It's a blank look.
Blank look, yeah. So you're not sure whether they're interested, not interested. So we all want feedback when we engage in any form of communication, right? It's an important part to understand, you know, to just build that rapport and to, you know, to communicate. But it's, you know, it's not something that takes forever to get used to. And as I say, not everybody is like that.
So what do you do then? So if you've got the end of a presentation and you haven't got that feedback, or you've actually asked for questions and nobody quite, but you do want to get some feedback. I mean, how do you approach it? What do? Do you encourage them to say something, or do you just leave it?
Yes, I mean, so you do try and encourage the group to ask you questions. But one thing that typically happens in a lot of meetings, especially corporate side of things, is in the group they don't have questions. So your best bet, if there's a group they don't seem to want to engage much, is to then set up separate meetings, especially with one or two critical stakeholders or decision makers.
Yes.
And then one-on-one they'll open up a lot more. So sometimes in the group they tend not to want to say anything.
Okay.
But it's just this formality that you present to the group.
Yes.
But the real communication then happens one-on-one or in a smaller group. So yes, do, you know, end the presentation or end your discussion, try and encourage questions, you know, is there anything else I can help you with, or, you know, do I need to clarify anything, or
yes,
like you would in any presentation. But if you don't get a reaction, I mean, don't force it, don't like, come on guys, tell me what you think kind of thing. No, just try and set up a follow-up meeting with a smaller group or one-on-one, and then you'll probably get a more honest, open discussion.
It's very interesting what you said about the this reluctance, that of asking perhaps questions in a group,
right?
But they're more likely to do it individually, And I think that is a big difference also in certain cultures. When a group, they won't do that, and they, whereas I think a lot of Western cultures, individuality is welcome. So you have that person who will put their hand up and ask. But I've noticed in some Asian cultures, I see when I'm teaching, for example, Asian students, they're not likely to be very vocal, but they'll come to you at the end,
right,
and ask
absolutely.
Questions,
yeah, yeah.
because they just don't want to to be out there sort of being really loud.
Yeah, but, and one of the things that I've learned is, you know, you tend to think that the most vocal person in the meeting is the most important person, and that you kind of need to engage with that person, because we all, as I say, we all want someone to give us feedback, right? So we naturally kind of latch on to the person who's asking us questions, but they may not be the decision maker. They may just be a manager, but whose just style is very vocal, and the real decision makers are happy to have them ask a lot of questions, and they just sit there and nod. But don't dismiss the quiet types as in, you know, oh, they're not important. Because often they're the senior people in the room. And they're, you know, just quietly evaluating you and seeing what you're doing.
Wow, okay, yeah. So they're evaluating you, working out what you're like, who you are. And yeah, that's great advice, yeah. Because some of, you know, the noisier people are not always the most important people in the meeting. So great, thank you very much, Roberto.
Yeah.
Tip 5, we're already at tip 5, wow. Let's how are we doing with time? I hope you can all stay with us because we're running a bit late here. But number 5, which is something that we stress a lot with the British, and the English language is very much like that, which is being polite, being diplomatic, and particularly when you're in meetings with people, it's if you object to something, how, and you know, with the British it would be try to be a bit more diplomatic. People are a bit more direct these days, but they'll try and start find ways of, you know, not saying that, you know, I think your idea, for example, is rubbish. They'll say, you know, well, I don't quite agree. And we use a lot of softening language to sound more diplomatic. What is it like with the Malaysians?
Yeah,
they don't
absolutely.
Agree with you, do they just
no,
go
no.
straight
so,
and tell
I mean,
you?
If it's your typical Malaysian style Asian culture, definitely. I mean, you're very diplomatic. You definitely don't want to have, you know, public disagreements or major conflict or going on in these meetings. It's a definite no-no. So yeah, diplomacy goes a long way. But again, as I say, the business environment is changing very quickly. As I say, the whole rise of startup culture has changed a lot of things. But generally, if you compare the Asian culture versus West, well, let me not generalize Asian culture, let's just be specific Malaysian, it still is quite diplomatic compared certainly to an American culture,
yes.
for example, where, you know, you can have open disagreements in meeting and it's fine, everybody walks out of the room happy. Whereas in Malaysia, you definitely want to try and keep the meeting as diplomatic as possible, certainly at the early stages. You don't want to have those open disagreements. If you disagree, doesn't mean you have to, you know, if somebody says something factually incorrect, of course you can correct them. But again, depending on who they are, your relationship with that person, are you the client, are you the, you know, the vendor, etc. You just need to see, you know, how to phrase it. But be polite.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, as much as you can be polite.
Politeness is always an important thing.
Yes,
absolutely.
Yes. Yeah.
But yes, it's interesting. Yes, we do, you know, in Asia, it's very much, you don't want confrontation. They don't like confrontation,
right.
So you have to always bear that in mind. Tip 6, humor. Okay, British have a very famous sense of humor. We were talking about it earlier, but quite often Americans don't understand the British with a sense of humor. They don't quite know whether you've said it, made a joke or not. The Malaysians, and we say, you know, often, for example, if a meeting is getting very tense, you know, sometimes the British will say, oh gosh, you know, they'll make a comment like, ooh, get the air conditioning on because this place is really heating up or whatever, just to break that moment of tension. You know, it's not a question about cracking jokes or being the funniest person. It's just having, and you know, the British are also famous for not taking themselves too seriously. What are the Malaysians like? Do they have a sense of humor?
Malaysians definitely have a sense of humor, but in the business context, the difference with the British is the British are a fairly homogeneous bunch, generally, right?
So homogeneous being...
They're all quite alike.
Yes, they're quite alike, yes.
So, you know, and better or worse, most of them will speak good English, they understand the same things, they tend to watch the same kind of programs, you know. There's definitely the culture is a lot tighter.
Yes.
Right? It's mm-hmm. almost similar. In Malaysia, there's big diversity.
Yes.
And even just the level, the proficiency in English, in terms of what they understand or how they speak, the accents, everything varies depending on who they are, what ethnicity they are, what kind of background in terms of education they've had. Has it all been local? Has it been overseas and so on? They watch different kind of programs, they read different kind of things. So there is definitely Malaysian humor, which a Malaysian would understand.
Yes.
And if you're a Malaysian, generally you can kind of get away with that. But then if you're a Westerner or if you're a foreigner, what may be funny to you might not be funny to them. They may not even understand it.
Yes.
So my general advice in meetings, unless, as I say, unless the party you're presenting to is trying to crack some jokes, so, you know, injecting a bit of humor, then definitely react to that. Don't be stiff and like, you know, let me get back to the presentation kind of thing. But I would say it's best avoid it until you've established a really good rapport with someone.
Yes.
Because often humor can backfire.
Okay, so backfire means go against you.
Yes, yes.
Yes?
It can,
yeah.
It, you know, you want it to have a certain effect and it just doesn't.
Yes.
And there's nothing worse than, you know, trying to crack a joke and the audience just gives you this blank stare and just, you know, it's telling you to kind of hurry up with your presentation.
Absolutely.
And stop wasting time.
Yes.
So generally I'd avoid it. My recommendation would be to avoid it if you can.
Yeah.
Simply because there's a high likelihood it might be misunderstood.
Yes.
Given the diversity of culture, unless you know the person well.
Interesting. Okay. I mean, which is what we always say with a lot of British who, you know, with a lot of native speakers of English, say, for example, we take the Americans or the British or the Australians, where they might, use their own culture-specific humor, which then will be misunderstood because unless you understand the context.
Yes.
So it's very important to stick with the standard English and the international way of understanding it, of not being too cultural specific.
Right.
So yeah, that's great. That's, you know, great advice. Right. Okay. Now the other thing I wanted to ask you, and there's only a couple more questions I'm going to ask you here, because I also know our audience have busy lives and they've got to get on with things. Is, and also you're a busy man.
Absolutely. Yeah. Maybe my nap.
Yes. Yes. And I know that we have our dog Marmite here, my brother's dog, who's waiting to go for her walk.
Licking my hands. Yes.
Yeah. She's very keen. Now, self-promotion.
Right.
When we talk about self-promoting, so, you know, we have certain cultures who are very pleased to, there she is, Marmite is there. So to say, Marmite, I don't know whether you can see her.
She's okay. There you go. Okay,
and
yes,
she's self-promoting. So when we're giving a presentation, one of the things the British don't like is when you talk a lot about yourself, about how great you are, how wonderful you are. That's one of the things that I don't always agree, because I think the British are very hard on people who are proud of the achievements of what they've done. But basically, they don't like it. You can talk about the successes of your company, the success of your products, but not a lot about yourself. Now, with the Malaysians, what is it like? Can you go in there and go, I'm Roberto Kumaraswamy, I'm, you know, I can get you the great results, I'm this, I'm that. What is it like? Are we talking the difference between
the
traditional
and startups? So, no, we're definitely more similar to the Brits. To the British as compared to the Americans. I mean, I think the Americans are in a class of their own when it comes to, you know, boasting about their own achievements. Having said that, of course, everybody likes confidence.
Yes.
So, you know, everybody is attracted to confidence. Everybody wants to deal with someone who seems to know what they're talking about and is capable of delivering what they say they're going to deliver. But you do it in terms of, you know, presenting your company, being confident in the outcomes you can deliver, but you wouldn't go in there boasting about yourself personally.
Yes.
I mean, I think, yes, generally it's not, Asian culture is not one of promoting the individual over the group. It's more about usually the group rather than the individual.
Yes.
But again, times are changing, you know, in a startup culture, often it's about that entrepreneur that is selling himself. The rise of social media obviously has led to a lot more self-promotion in all cultures. So you've really got to get, you know, it really depends what the situation is. So be confident, but yes, don't boast.
Yes, it's not all about you, basically.
No,
what you can offer.
Correct.
The audience.
Yes.
So it's a very interesting. So looking back at your 20 years, and of course you're still young, how has business in Malaysia changed? You're talking a lot about these startup companies now. Have you seen this huge change? I mean, are there a lot more entrepreneurs? Is it easy to set up a company in Malaysia, do well in Malaysia?
Well, okay, but that's quite a broad question. So, I mean, if we just talk in terms of how the culture has changed,
yes,
it definitely has changed.
Mm-hmm.
It's also a generation thing.
Yes.
I mean, there's this whole, you know, rise of the millennials.
Yes.
So even the stiffest corporate companies are having to hire, you know, your early 20s, you know, people who are in the early 20s, you know, who make up the bulk of the workforce.
Yes.
And that is a group that values different things in the workplace.
Yes.
And expects different things. So by necessity, if any company wants to retain these people and wants to make them do well, they can't be as stiff as they used to be. And I think this applies across the world. It's not,
yes,
you know, it's not specific to Malaysia. So by virtue of that, most companies are generally becoming a little bit more informal.
Yes.
And trying to value open communication and so on and so forth, and, you know, open door policy and all of that. But again, you know, there are limits, right? You know, when you're still dealing with your senior guys, if they're the more traditional types, they don't care whether you're a millennial or not, you respect them and, you know, you follow the protocol. But things have definitely changed.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. But again, in my case, even when I started, I was working with British American Tobacco, which is a multinational. Even 20 years ago, they valued a very, you know, kind of open, informal thing. But that's simply because they were a Western-oriented type of company. So that,
yes,
they wanted that culture to pervade, you know, across all their companies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's what they wanted. But yeah, you're absolutely right. So, Roberto, what generation do you belong to? Are you a millennial? Would you like?
I would like to consider myself a millennial, but unfortunately, I'm not a millennial. Not quite a baby boomer either. So I'm what, Generation X? I think.
Yeah, you and I are Generation X.
No, you might be a baby boomer though.
I'm actually on the cusp of Generation X.
Yeah,
yes,
yeah.
Very interesting. So yes, okay, so it's the younger people that are coming, but you know, I think
people.
You are with that baseball.
I know. This
you're
is
still a millennial.
This is how I'm going to work every day. Yes. Absolutely.
Yeah. So
right.
You know, you're an entrepreneur.
Oh yes.
Moved on
yes.
to that. But anyway, well, really, thank you so much for sharing, and also for sharing with my followers. It's really great because, you know, I can see it from one perspective, and there's so much more different cultures, but of course, still using the English language as a form of communication in this part of the world.
Yeah.
And so that's great. I hope that you found this of interest. Hi, Mohammed, you're listening from Pakistan, and I know a number of people have been coming in and out, so I hope you guys found this lesson interesting. It was slightly different, and as I said, it was a surprise for Christmas, introducing you to my brother, introducing you to a different part of the world in terms of how we do business, but always using English as that form of communication, that international language. So it's been really helpful with your tips. So what I want to say, guys, is thank you so much for listening. Don't forget that if you don't forget to sign up to my small talk club, and I'll drop you a line with the link later when I share the video with you. And that is for the upcoming perfectly stimulating small talk book of recipes that I'll be launching in the new year. And of course, small talk must be a big thing also in Malaysia, right?
Yes, I mean, absolutely.
Business
everywhere.
Is done not just in the
Completely.
Boardroom.
The real business is done outside the boardroom.
Exactly.
That's
so outside the boardroom, in the bars.
Yeah.
And you're a great, you know all the bars.
I know all the bars, yes.
In Kuala Lumpur. In fact, we'll be joining him soon. But seriously, that's where a lot of business is done, on the golf course. And that's where we engage with most of our business. So, you know, make sure you sign up to my small talk club and get more sneak previews as I start doing them. I haven't been able to do them just yet, but I will be really busy with Christmas holidays. And speaking of which, Christmas, I'm going to be off now. So Wednesdays with English with a Twist will return on the, let me just think, that is the 10th, 11th, the 12th of January for the next live lesson. And you know, I hope you can join me then. In the meantime, I want you, for all of you who celebrate Christmas, I wish you a very Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Roberto, me do. We celebrate Christmas, so we'll be celebrating. I hope you noticed the Christmas
fabulous
tree.
Yeah.
That's wonderful. And a very happy new year. Let's hope that 2017 is a lot better than what 2016 has been in terms of the political situation around this world. But I hope you guys have a wonderful time. See you in 2017. Thanks so much for watching. Ciao.
Bye,
take care.
Everyone.
Ciao for now. Bye.